Today's movie has definitely left audiences split over the years, but it sure is bloody. Welcome to Sick Flicks, where I take a deep dive into the cinematic sewer to help you embrace your inner gore geek. I'm Mike Bracken, aka The Horror Geek, and today we're covering Alexander Aja's new French Extremity classic, Haute Tension. Released in 2003, Haute Tension is one of the most controversial horror films to emerge in the past 20 years. And, oddly enough, the controversy doesn't spring from the violence or the gore or the subject matter, but instead a plot twist and claims of plagiarism. Aja's film has divided genre fans for nearly two decades thanks to a late-in-the-game narrative 180 that many fans feel is a cheat. The film has also earned the ire of Dean Koontz fans who feel it used dangerously close to the author's novel Intensity. We'll talk about the plot twist more later, but let's answer the easy question first. Is Haute Tension gory enough to earn a 5 barf bag rating? Let's get to the gore and find out. We fade in on some wannabe Goldilocks who looks like she had a really bad run-in with the three bears. Then it's time for a flashback. Which is a record. I don't think we've ever had a flashback this fast on an episode of Sick Flicks. Goldilocks is busy trying to get away from the three bears. If you listen closely, you can hear Papa Bear screaming, "Hey, you picked the wrong house for a home invasion, lady!" She's basically just stumbling through the woods, which is not only filled with bears, but deadly credits as well. Oh hey, it's Philippe Nahon. You might remember him from Gaspar Noé movies like Irreversible or I Stand Alone. Yeah, we're gonna get to those eventually. Also, sad fact, Nahon passed away earlier this year. Anyway, after some more credits, she runs out right in front of this car. Driver dude's like, "Well, guess I need to stop and buy underwear at the next gas station. Thanks, lady." And then, she wakes up in the back of a car. Oh look, it's Ellen DeGeneres. She's out here on a road trip with French Liv Tyler. Man, I had the weirdest dream. Suddenly, I'm craving porridge.
Don't you ever have normal dreams?
Well, sure. I once dreamt I was the female lead in a rom-com with Bill Pullman. I mean, can you imagine? Over in another movie, Philippe Nahon has stopped for a little roadside lovin'. He finishes up telling her, "Why don't you just quit while you're ahead?" Then tosses her out the window like he's the dad of Sven Garrett in Murder Set Pieces. Back with Ellen and Liv, who are actually Marie and Alex, we wind up in this cornfield. Watch out for Malachi and He Who Walks Behind the Rose. Wait, wrong movie. Eventually, they get out to investigate like a couple of horror film rookies.
Stop it! Qu'est-ce qu'il y a?
With all this corn around, it's no surprise Marie's being stalked.
Alex! Je jure, si c'est une blague, tu vas le regretter.
Hope she doesn't get lost in there. It's kind of a maze. I'm just gonna go ahead and apologize for both of those now. If you have any complaints, just leave them in the comments section. Because like this field, I'm all ears. As it turns out, this is all a fake out. Man, not even a jump scare. How corny. From there, they arrive at Alex's parents' place. Man, I'm no interior designer, but this place has some really ugly wallpaper. Before heading to bed, we learn Alex is into unavailable men.
En même temps, il a une copine, hein? Il a pas l'air de vouloir la quitter.
I'm no dating and relationship expert, but this sounds like a recipe for disaster.
Enfin, moi, je me fais toujours des mecs libres.
Meanwhile, Ellen's over here like, "You know who'd be great together? Us." Then Alex asks Marie about taking the plunge.
Bon, et toi, Marie? Quand est-ce que tu décides à franchir le pas?
Is she just totally clueless or what? She's not into men. With everyone ready for bed, Marie heads outside for a smoke and gets a little peep show in the process. Then she heads to bed. But first, she's gonna have a little menage a moi while she listens to some Janelle Monáe on her Walkman. I don't think this is what they meant when they came up with the slogan, "Just let your fingers do the walking." Do you kids even remember that? Or Walkmans? Christ, I'm old. While she's punching her one-way ticket to O-Town, someone's driving through the corn. Wait, is that the Creeper from Jeepers Creepers? If not, I think they might have bought their trucks at the same dealership. The killer finally arrives, and at least he's polite, because he rings the doorbell.
Quiet, Jesus. Who is it?
Man, these Jehovah's Witnesses never sleep. Philippe Nahon doesn't take kindly to Dad here rejecting his copy of Awake, so he decides he's gonna have to beat the devil out of him instead. Then he goes all Michael Myers and kills the dog too. So Safe journey across the Rainbow Bridge, Hendrix. Turns out Dad's still alive, but not for long. Philippe Nahon, who's simply called the killer in the credits, really does kind of look like an older, gone-to-see Michael Myers. He gets to work jamming Dad's head between the stair rails and decides it's time to rearrange the furniture. Upstairs, Mom's awake. I bet he's down there on the phone with Jake from State Farm again. Joke's on her because he's never gonna be on the phone with anyone unless he gets one of those hands-free headsets. Mom heads downstairs and finds that Dad has really lost his head over things tonight.
Dad.
The killer's about to give her a shave, but if you're wondering what Marie is up to during all this, she's busy trying to get the hell out of Paris. She's gonna call for help, but is interrupted by a totally expected guest coming up the stairs. With the killer fast approaching, she tidies up the room and hides. If you guessed she was hiding in the shower like a total dope, well, no screenwriter's credit for you. Instead, she's in the second most obvious place, under the bed. But somehow, the killer doesn't spot her when he checks. After a tense game of cat and mouse, he finally leaves to go spend some quality time with Alex. I'm hunting wabbits. Marie, meanwhile, sneaks downstairs like this is Splinter Cell, but still can't find a phone. And since hiding under the bed wasn't enough of a cliche, she doubles down by hiding in the closet this time instead. If you were wondering what happened to the mother, wonder no more. She's still alive, but not for long. She just wants to reach out and touch someone, but so does the killer. The difference is he wants to do it with his straight razor. With Marie watching, he finishes Mom off. Man, they're never gonna get that blood off those doors. Might as well just repaint them. She comes out to check on Mom, and surprise, she's not dead. But she is full of existential questions and missing a hand. While the killer's distracted with the kid, Marie heads off to find Alex chained and gagged. She's like, wow, this is my fantasy made real. Too bad there's a killer running amok. While she's busy trying to free Alex, the killer offs the kid with the double-barreled shotgun. Man, this movie's not messing around. He comes back for Alex and loads her into his truck like she's a bag of croissants, but then takes one last look in the house. While he's inside, Marie's sneaking around like this is manhunt and she's James Earl Cash. But before she can rescue Alex, the killer is back and locks her in the truck too. Alright, time to get some smokes. But before we go, here's one last look at the killer's handiwork. Yeah, that's some good gore. While Marie and Alex are figuring out their escape, the killer's adding a new trophy to his rear view. Clearly, this isn't this dude's first rodeo. He's also not the best role model because he's busy downing his booze while driving. Man, I totally earned this after a hard day's killing. They eventually pull over for gas, and Marie finds herself in yet another stealth mission as she sneaks out of the truck. She actually makes it inside and asks the attendant to call the cops. But you know how it is, you don't get good help when you're paying minimum wage. Plus, the killer is right behind her, and surprise, he and the counter guy know each other.
You know, c'est pas mal pour amener une gonzesse ici le soir.
Well, sure, but it's not as nice as that rolling slaughterhouse you've got. Then things get awkward when the counter guy notices the blood on the killer's hands. And really, you gotta give Philippe Nahon credit here. He looks like a killer. He also looks like he uses the scent of Marlboros and pepperoni grease straight out of his pores, but that makes the character work. Anyway, counter dude goes to get him another bottle and is rewarded with an axe in the chest for his efforts.
C'est pour me.
Ah! I axed you for Grey Goose, not Smirnoff's, damn it. Don't make me ax you again. Marie takes this as her cue to bail, running down to the ladies' room like this is a scene from Maniac. Hey, do you mind? I'm trying to drop a deuce in here, man. Before he heads out, he stops to hose off the porcelain. Hey, that booze had to come out eventually, right? He does finally leave, and Marie sneaks out. And again, this feels like it was clearly inspired by a sequence in Maniac, except it doesn't pay off with Marie getting killed. While she's busy screwing around, the killer's leaving, and Alex is going with him. Marie actually gets the cops on the line this time, but she can't give them any useful information.
Non, j'ai pas le numéro, j'étais à l'intérieur, je vous l'ai dit, j'ai pas pu voir.
With the cops no help, she takes the dead guy's keys and gun and takes matters into her own hands. Who's ready for some vigilante justice? Well, hold that thought. Eventually, they wind up way out in the woods with Marie doing the most obvious tail job ever. Here's some career advice, Marie. Don't ever think about becoming a private eye. The killer's clearly on her scheme because next thing you know, he's reenacting Steven Spielberg's duel and ramming her from behind. No, not like that, you pervs. I meant with his truck. She's ready to pull a drive-by, but if you guess the gun is empty, give yourself a screenwriter's credit. Marie's got the faster car, but she's a terrible driver, and she doesn't have any of those banana peels like in Mario Kart. God, I hate those banana peels in Mario Kart. Anyway, she's basically off-roading now and catches some sweet air before ending up upside down. Seems like maybe the killer had a blue turtle shell. You know, some people pay to put flame graphics on their car, but Marie's all about keeping it real. And if you think this is the end of Marie, don't worry. She's alive, but definitely a little worse for wear. Car doesn't look too bad, does it? Most of that will buff right out. A little Bondo and it'll be good as new. Hope my insurance rates don't go up. She flees the scene of the accident and finds herself in this weird greenhouse. Apparently, the killer has a lucrative side gig growing his own marijuana. She's fixing herself up, but like Jesse Ventura said in Predator, she ain't got time to bleed because here comes the killer. They're playing some cat and mouse amongst his purple kush when Marie finds herself a makeshift weapon. Guess she's gonna be Negan for Halloween. Her cosplay version of Lucille could probably use a little work. Newly armed, the hunted now becomes the hunter. Except, surprise, the flashlight is a trap. Guess we should have seen that one coming. The killer takes this opportunity to pounce, wrapping Marie in plastic like she's that video restorationist chick in the last broadcast. He knocks her out, and then this whole thing turns into some weird half-ass therapy session.
Qu'est-ce que tu lui veux, Alex? Elle t'excite, hein? Eh ben moi aussi, elle m'excite.
Well, you know what I always say, it's good to find common ground with people, even if they're psychos. While he's giving her an impromptu dental exam, looks good, no cavities, she beans him on the head with something and then reenacts Glenn's death scene from The Walking Dead, only with way less eyeball popping. He's like, why are you beating me with this thing? She keeps on tenderizing his face like it was a $2 steak, and eventually the killer quits moving. But he can't be dead that easily, right? Of course he can't. He goes all Blackjack Mulligan and locks in the claw on Marie's throat while she tries to smother him. It's a race to see who asphyxiates first. Luckily for Marie, the killer's not great at holding his breath. So, you may be thinking, alright, this is the happy ending we've all been waiting for, right? Well, not so fast. Remember how I told you this movie was divisive? Well, here's why. Back at the gas station, the cops finally show up. They find the dead attendant, but they also find the security tape, and what's on the tape might surprise you. Unless you've already seen this movie. What the hell? Marie killed him? Back in the woods, Marie finds Alex, who doesn't seem too excited to see her. When she's free, she grabs the knife Marie gave her earlier, and we get a standoff. And we learn that not only did Marie kill the gas station attendant, she killed the whole family and kidnapped Alex to boot. With that out of the way, Alex gets stabby. and it's not Marie who's our final girl, but Alex instead. But rather than finish her off, Alex flees into the woods, and surprise, the killer's back and in rough shape. Oh, and he's got this portable circular saw and is ready to work on some home improvement projects. Alex flees right back into the start of the movie like this is some demented version of Groundhog Day. Except this time, Alex is in the car and the guy can't get it to start, and Marie slash the killer is closing in fast and ready to put that saw to work. He should have probably just split. With the driver dead, it's Alex's turn, but before Marie slash the killer can finish her off, she manages to escape with a crowbar. Oh, and a giant sliver of glass in her foot. Guessing she won't be signing up for ballet anytime soon. Killer closes the gap and then starts asking a bunch of questions.
Tu m'aimes? Tu m'aimes pas?
Sure I do. I love you like a friend and like a sister. Marie takes this as the go-ahead to move in for the kiss, except Alex still has that crowbar, which she uses to pry open Marie's rib cage. That's gonna leave a mark. And things come full circle with Marie uttering the lines from the start of the movie before revealing that she's now institutionalized. So, no discussion of High Tension is complete without talking about the twist. Some folks really hate the big twist reveal that Marie is the killer. They feel like it's a cheat. But when I first wrote about this film way back in 2003, I pointed out that the twist makes sense, for the most part, within the narrative of the story. We start with Marie. It's her story, and she's an unreliable narrator.
Ça y est, c'est enregistré.
The problems of things not lining up are completely explained by her telling the story to show herself favorably and presumably being mentally ill. So, if you don't like the twist, I totally get it. But it's not quite the cheat it's been portrayed to be for years. Could it have been handled better? Definitely. But it makes sense in its own twisted logic way. But hey, I love Friday the 13th, A New Beginning, and I don't care that it's not actually Jason either, so I may just look at things differently. But really, who cares about the twist? We're here for the gore. How does High Tension measure up in terms of splatter? Let's go to the gore card. In terms of gross anatomy, High Tension delivers. This is some more vintage Gennetto De Rossi gore work and another great example of why I loved the new French Extremity movement. We've got a decapitation, a brutal throat slash, one shotgun murder, an axing, a barbed wire bat beatdown, death by concrete saw, and a brutal shard of glass removal. The effects work is excellent. Although I'd expect nothing less from De Rossi, who's one of the all-time great splatter technicians. This is a brutal film that typifies the new French Extremity movement and never shies away from the gore. Because of that, High Tension gets a full 5 barf bag rating from me. This is definitely a sick flick. Looking for more French gore? Then check out my review of Frontiers. You'll find a link here on the screen. I'll meet you over there. Until next time, I'm Mike Bracken, aka The Horror Geek, bringing you all the splatter that matters.